Okay, so yes, we can start. So maybe just some kind of administrative or non-SOS thing. I think it would be really great if people try to informally work together on the exercises, just going over the lecture notes. So I will do like an open thread in Piazza every time after every lecture, but also feel free to just, you know, just talk to each other. And personally, I think it would be particularly good if you'd find groups that kind of go beyond across Harvard MIT boundaries or across, you know, Leeds boundaries or whatever. So just, you know, I don't want to coordinate this kind of thing, just feel free. And also, I would appreciate it if you do solve the exercises that you post your solutions on Piazza. It would be useful for me for future future iterations, and also useful for the other students. You just, you know, give it a headline of like a subject of solution for exercise, and then people that didn't yet do the exercise know that they shouldn't look at it. So anyway, I'm trying to keep these kind of things basically informal, but I think it would be great if it happened. Okay, so today I want to kind of the topic for today is kind of the Bayesian SOS and the planted clique problem. And one of these will be very kind of very high level, the other will be very technical, but hopefully there is a mix of both. And we'll see why I think the planted clique problem is a good problem to demonstrate this issue, but it's by no means the only one. So in particular, let me start with the second thing. What are we going to see this lecture? So basically this lecture we are going to see that the following holds. If we let S be some random subsets of M size omega, so let's say it will end to 0.49, and we let G be selected from Gm half union Ks. By this I mean that I take a random graph, every edge is derby probability half, and I add a clique on S. Then what we should see is that with high probability we can find a pseudo-distribution mu, you know, for every d, which is lower than 1. With high probability, you can find a degree d pseudo distribution mu that satisfies expectation with respect to mu of xi xj squared. I guess. Since these are 0, 1 variable, we might as well just say x, I, x, j is 0 for every I that's not connected to j in G, and expectation of sum x, I is omega. Now, so far this is not very impressive. You know, the graph has a clique,
and basically notice that this condition, if you're talking about the distribution over zero 1 to the n, then basically this condition tells you that it must be supported on cliques, because this thing is always non-negative, right, if it's in 0, 1 to the n. So, so if there was even one non-edge that had positive probability in any of the support of mu, this would be positive. So this tells you that this is supported on cliques, and this tells you that basically the average the average size is omega, and because the average because omega is the largest clique, then basically if this was an actual distribution into it, so if this was if mu is actual distribution, then we would get that mu is really basically just has support one. It's just completely completely focused on the actual clique that we've done, because with very high probability in a random graph, it's kind of an exercise. I think it is an exercise to show that with high probability you don't get more than O of log n, in fact 2 times log n sized clique. So there's only one clique of size so large, and that's the clique we put in. So if it was an actual distribution, it's this. But the somehow weird thing is that this is not going to be the distribution. So in particular, this should be mean that expectation of say xi according to mu should be either one if I is in S and 0 if I is not in S. Right? But this is not weird. The weird thing is this is not what we are going to get. We are going to get an expectation of xi is going to be roughly omega over n for every I. And we are going to get expectation of xi xj is going to be roughly omega, there's some constant, but basically omega squared over n squared for every I connected to j. So, et cetera. So this is basically weird. So basically, in some sense, mu pretends to have high entropy. In particular, entropy larger than zero. So, right. So the true in the true case, every distribution with these properties should have zero entropy. But the distribution we produce pretends to have kind of significant entropy. It pretends to be almost in some sense pairwise, freewise, fourwise, independent, etc. So it's kind of weird. Like in some sense, it's a distribution that doesn't make sense. Like I'm giving you these kind of moments, and you kind of know that there is no way they make sense. There's no way they could correspond to the actual thing in this group. And what's possibly even weirder is that. Say mu works even without adding the clique. So now basically there is no distribution. So now there is no distribution that satisfies this condition. I'm not sure what's the right way to think about the entropy. Maybe it should be we should think that here the true entropy. Is like log of zero minus infinity. So, there's negative entropy, but we still the same mu, even though there is kind of negative entropy, we still have the same mu, and we can even talk about something like, can define something like, expectation gives us a concrete value for expectation of x17, which basically, if you think about it, what is X17? It's the probability that vertex 17 is in the non-existent omega clique. Right? So basically, you know, the graph doesn't have a clique, but I'll still give you probabilities of what's the probability that vertex 17 is contained inside this clique that doesn't exist. This is why I kind of sometimes like to compare these kind of probabilities to, you know, the probability that a unicorn has blue eyes. Right? So there are no unicorns, but we still can talk about their properties.
So,
yes. Yes.
Does expectation on X actually be 1, or would it be like something like 1 over W, or something? Like 1 over omega, or 1 over...
So, where is the question? Here?
Here, yeah.
No, it would be 1, right? Because if U was actually fully supported, it can only support 1, and only on the characteristic vector of S, then, you know, an expectation of xi would simply mean, you know, 1s at the point i.
Is that 1s isn't, like, normalized to anything, it's just
the number of 1s? No, it's like some xi equals omega, right? So it's a, so it's like a 0, 1, right? X is in kind of 0, 1 to the n. And, right, so in the case that... No, the x that should be the case is like zero one. But basically, if, for example, you had like the uniform distribution over all sets, which of course doesn't make sense because there is only one clique, but then you get that this would be like omega over n for everyone. Right, so note that this sums up to the same thing, right? This sums up to omega, and this also sums up to omega. But, yeah, so in some sense this makes sense, right? The probability that either I is in the clique or that is not in the clique. So the probability is supposed to be either 0 or 1. But what we get is that is, we get these kind of probabilities that are not 0 or 1. And basically we kind of want to interpret what do these probabilities mean. And this is the interpretation we mean is basically we want to define the following. We say that expectation, so here is interpretation so one interpretation could be the following, that when we say, you know, that the pseudo expectation of xa, I mean the product of xi for I in a. So basically what we think is, what is xA? It's the price that you pay for the, you know, x, so the A in S stock. What do I mean by that? I mean, suppose I planted this clique, and I told you suppose we planted clique, gave you the graph, and I told you now you can. So we have this game. We give out the graph, and a month later we also give out the clique, and. And in the meantime, people can place bets on events like the probability that some subset A is in the clique. And so suppose there is a market where you can buy a stock like that would pay $1 if A is in the clique. So how much would you pay for this thing? So basically, a priori, for example, for if A is a single vertex, the base case, if you didn't even look at the graph, you would say it's about omega over n. You know, if the price was consistently below that, then you could make money. If the price was consistently above that, maybe you could, betting with the negation, you could make money. But once you look at the graph, maybe you update your probabilities. If you had unbounded computational time, then, okay, so who is you, right? So that's the question, right? If you had unbounded computational time, then the price that you'd pay for every such stock is either 0 or 1, because you would find the maximum clique, and either either A is in this S or not. But if you don't have unbounded computational time, then we believe this clique is a hard problem, then your price probably is not 0 or 1, it's something else. And what is this something else? So so we could say that basically one way to come up with these prices is using sum of squares, and for this problem at least, at the moment, this is the best algorithm we know to come up with these prices. We don't know of an algorithm that's better that's better for this, but these prices are right. So these prices for the planted clique, which is why it's kind of useful to think of this Bayesian setting, in the clique case, the prices are not super trivial, right? So basically, if you look at, so let's do some exercise. Suppose the degree of 17 is equal to n over 2 plus, I don't know, 5 standard deviations, square root n, whatever, like 1 standard deviation, doesn't matter, and omega is like, let's say it's pretty close to square root n, it's like epsilon square root n. So, if I just give you this information, what should be the expectation of F17? Right, so first of all, is it going to be bigger or smaller than omega over n? Yes. Bigger, right? Because, you know, if all else being equal, if you know that the vertex has more higher degree than average, then it's should be at least a little bit more likely to be in the clique. But now, suppose we want to compute by how much is it supposed to be more likely. Then one way to think about it is the following. We kind of want to look at, right, that's why they call these people Bayesians, because you always use Bayes' law, right? So you say the prior is, right, so you want to look at the probability. So basically you want to look at the probability that 17 is in the clique. And you want to look at basically the probability that 17 is in the clique conditioned on the degree of 17 being, say, n over 2 plus 5 square root n. And basically this is, right, this is like probability of 17 is in the clique and the degree n over 2 plus square root n divided by the probability that the degree and just basically what happens if 17 is in the clique, then it means that the degree of 17 is basically a binomial with mean n over 2 plus omega, right? How do you write these things? Binomial, okay, so let me write as normal because I'm always confused. No, so it's basically a normal with n over 2 omega and variance. Right? And if 17 is not in the clique,
then this is like n, n over 2.
So roughly speaking, this is basically the difference is it's a shift by omega over square root and standard deviations. So when you do the calculation, what will be is that basically you get 1 over n plus some constant times omega over square root n. And more generally, like the basically there is some correlation, and so you can compute basically the correlation of the degree and xi. And if you don't compute that, you will lose money, right? If you bet against me, and even we are both computationally bounded, but you somehow neglect to include this information, then you will lose money because I will consistently look at the degrees and bet against you, and I will win. And the closer omega is to square root n, the bigger my kind of advantage could be. And it's not a priori clear that sum of squares that the sum of squares algorithm so can take into account, so can somehow you run the sum of squares algorithm to give you a pseudo distribution. It's not a priori clear that it takes into account this kind of soft information that you should somehow increase the degrees. You should increase the probability based on the degree. But the kind of interesting thing is that it does, even though some other natural algorithms do not. So the main result, in some sense, for planted clique is a negative result that says that to actually solve the problem, we sum of squares doesn't do at least very, very much better than other algorithms. But in some sense, it will, if you add this betting market on the clique, sum of squares will win against these other algorithms by some amount, just not a very, very large one. And here is just an open problem. Find a betting strategy, an efficient betting strategy, say n to the O of 1 time betting strategy for this planted clique game. That beats the SOS for every constant d. Right, so show that say for polynomial time algorithms, sum of squares is not optimal for this game. There is a strategy to beat it. I don't know of any such strategy. I think it would be very kind of interesting, and it seems like a very natural setting to ask. Right, so suppose I give you a market for betting on these kind of events. Can you find an I price things according to sum of squares of degree d? Can you win against me with a polynomial time strategy? We don't know. So.
Sorry, do you know what you're getting about?
So in some sense, yes, we kind of do know that somehow for LS plus, there are valid pseudo distributions that don't take into account these soft constraints. So,
but LS plus is enough.
What?
LS plus is subset.
Right, so I'm saying I can beat LS plus. Using sum of squares, I can beat LS plus.
I'm saying generally, so maybe the problem you can beat.
Ah, for this problem, we don't know. No, like extension complexity.
Yeah.
No, we don't know. So that's another question. If we can't do it, and you want to find a model in which you can prove, an impossibility result, then this is a model we'll talk about later, which is kind of extension complexity. And it's very interesting to know if your extension complexity, there is some issues with extension complexity in the plotted clique version. You have to define it. I think there are like some issues exactly how you define these things, because it's not an instance independent polytope, but I'm assuming that there is some good way to define it. Okay, so in some sense, the sum of squares is kind of, it gives us this some natural way to come up with probabilities, and let me even try to see if I can. I can get this thing. I don't know if you've seen this figure on our website. We kind of so proud of it that the. Okay, so. So there is this figure that I'm very proud of. I mean, I have nothing to be proud of, David did it, but I'm proud for him. It's, what's that?
That's not my...
That's actually weird, isn't it? That's just super weird. I think that's my email. if it is, that's maybe laptop too. Ah, yes. Okay. Because that other person actually interested in the Grassmannian, and is actually something related to Unique Games. So that's actually very interesting. Whoever's laptop is that, like laptop one, they know something about the Grassmannian, I'd like to talk to them. Yeah, at some point we'll talk about Unique Games and etc. So in some sense, okay, so let me just say this is a fake figure in the sense that we didn't really run the sum of squares algorithm to compute it, but it does somehow... I think it's somehow visually similar to what you'll actually get. It's basically that in some sense, initially you run the sum of squares algorithm, initially all the vertices are uniform. You kind of, I guess this was kind of fast, but basically if you run sum of squares with an actual plotted clique, then somehow initially, so this kind of goes back and forth. So initially like all vertices get omega over n, and then you start looking at say degree statistics. And then you like start looking at triangle statistics, and maybe a four cycle or like some other graph statistics, etc., until you until you basically isolate the clique. And so basically the bets you would make will be more and more informed the more time you have. So anyway, I kind of like this figure. So So this kind of Bayesian view is good for us whenever we design algorithms, right? So basically, the idea is that we think of these sum of squares as giving us these kind of betting probabilities. the beliefs of a computationally bounded bounded agent. And one of the things of a computationally bounded agent is if you have an algorithm to come up with probabilities, you could cheat this algorithm and you could give it, say, in this case, like a graph where things don't exist. And because it doesn't know how to distinguish between these two things, it will still happily, you know, give prices and make bets on things that are just nonsensical. You know, it just like basically, you know, we might, if we had to bet right now about various mathematical theorems, then, you know, we probably, there are probably some false mathematical theorems that we think there is some probability that they are true. Right, so because we are bounded. So this Bayesian thing might seem like, you know, some cute philosophy and, you know, doesn't have anything to do with, you know, actual algorithms or log bounds, but we'll see today that it's useful for log bounds, but I want to also kind of say why it's also useful for algorithms. So basically, I don't know a lot about Bayesian data analysis. I think maybe Pablo can elaborate more. Is that basically the Bayesian approach to dealing with probabilities? So basically, they say, you know, on a philosophical level, we think of probabilities as actually talking about beliefs. And so we can talk about probabilities of things that are, you know, completely determined. So one example I have in the notes, I can talk about the probability that my great-grandfather had blue eyes. You know, of course he either had blue eyes or not, but I don't know. And at the moment, the only way I can, you know, I can only give probabilities about that because I can just look at the descendants and try to estimate what's the chance that he had blue eyes. But, you know, so even though this event already happened in the past, and is completely determined, in a Bayesian approach, I can talk about probabilities for that. So Bayesians, in some sense, philosophically think of probabilities very, very differently, but then they take these kind of probabilities, and I think mathematically, they assume that you can treat them as probabilities, and every mathematical theorem that we have proven about actual, you know, probabilities defined on sample space, etc., we can use, and not just Bayes theorem. Is that fair? Right, so we basically will try to do the same thing. So I kind of call it, you know, the Bayes-Marley approach. So basically, it's maybe one way to think about it is like, you know. Think like a Bayesian, and compute like a frequentist. So we'll basically we are given, say, for when we try to solve an algorithmic problem, we're typically not going to even, you know, if we try to solve it using sum of squares, we're typically not going to think about even, you know, squares, SDP, and all that. We'll basically say, okay, we are given this mu, you know, this mu that encodes all you know, the best beliefs we can come up with about, you know, some unknown x that is somewhere, and this x is a good solution for our problem, whatever the problem is. And basically our goal is to find some x star that is also kind of a decent solution. And when we do that, this, we can kind of assume two things. First of all, we can assume that every kind of property that we can, every kind of knowledge that we have that X should satisfy, then we can assume that mu satisfies. So basically, we can assume that for every simple function f, if you can deduce that, say, f must be, you know, if you can deduce that f must vanish on x, then expectation of mu of f should be zero. If we can assume that, you know, it should be in some interval, then we know that the expectation of f of mu should be in this interval. And then we can also then start pretending that this is an actual distribution, and we'll see that later in this course, where we actually pretend that this is an actual distribution and do all sorts of computation that makes sense if this was an actual distribution, and we just kind of cross our fingers and hope it will be all fine even if we use pseudo-distributions. And typically it will be. But this is how we use this for algorithm design, and we'll talk about it more later in this course. And in particular, for algorithm design, I think it's particularly attractive in the sense that it somehow changes the order of normal. If you've seen approximation algorithms based on convex relaxation, then typically, you first design the relaxation, then you try to come up with a rounding algorithm for the relaxation. And in this approach, the relaxation is almost immaterial. You first come up with the rounding algorithm, and then you look at your analysis of this rounding algorithm and try to fit the relaxation to the analysis and make sure that the relaxation is powerful enough so that it captures the analysis. And you hope, for example, that maybe large enough degree sum of squares will be powerful enough that it captures the analysis, and so you didn't need to think too hard. But in some sense, it's the order is kind of inverted in what you do. You do things, and it's, to me at least, feel like it's somewhat more systematic and requires less creativity. While sometimes you could look at relaxation-based algorithms and you ask, how did they come up with this relaxation? But basically, so this is how we use this kind of approach for upper bounds. But we'll also show how to use it for lower bounds. So for lower bounds, so if you recall, for sum of squares integrality gaps, so the canonical approach. So what is an integrality gap? Just so we remind ourselves, it's you get some instance, I of say maximization problem or whatever. Such that objective is small, but there exists a pseudo distribution such that, say, expected objective is large. And the pseudo distribution satisfies whatever constraints are there to satisfy. So this is an integrality gap, right? The true objective is small, there is a pseudo distribution that the objective is large. And this by the way, is not restricted to sum of squares. Essentially, this is how an integrality gap always looks for every convex relaxation. We just typically don't use the names pseudo distribution, we use the name fractional solution, or primal certificate or dual certificate, depending on what viewpoint we come up with. But basically, this is how we always prove a gap between the, say, integral or actual solutions and the kind of fake solutions that the relaxation comes up with. And the kind of canonical approach that people use for this kind of thing is, first of all, basically they guess the pseudo distribution and then prove it is valid. And again, this is always, if you look at any paper showing some integrality gaps, whether it's linear programming, some indefinite programming, some other things, typically that's what you will see. They will basically say, here is some particular set of numbers, and now we'll prove that it is valid, and therefore it certifies that, so they first of all prove somehow that the objective is small, and then they say, now despite the objective being small, here is some set of numbers that pretend the objective is large, and now we'll prove that it's valid. And typically, if you look at the paper and you see any, you never see how did they come up with this pseudo distribution. They just, they don't need to justify it, right? Because to show an integrality gap, they just need to show that it exists. So they just kind of pull it out of a hat. They just somehow guess it. In fact, often it's kind of supernatural that you almost don't need them to explain it. Like for linear programming, say MaxCut, often it's like the all half vector or something like that is this thing. So in some sense, it's almost so natural that you don't really need them to explain it. But there is something that bothers me about this, is that this step is this step is creative. I don't like creative steps. So the nice thing about the Bayesian approach is that in some sense you almost forced to write. If instead of guessing we say this pseudo distribution must basically satisfy the best bets that we can make given the information we have, then in some sense, as we'll see in the planted clique case, but it's kind of more general, there is basically almost no choice, no choice in how to choose this distribution. So in some sense, we can get rid of the guess. We still have to prove it. And right now, this step is still it's still somewhat creative, in the sense that, it's definitely hard. In fact, I'll not be able to even give you the full proof of PSDness for this particular thing here, but I'll kind of give you the outline of it and point you to the paper for the actual meat. Still working on trying to find, like, this is another great open problem, to find the right proof for this thing, but I feel like this also eventually should not be creative, because at the end of the day we do have efficient algorithms to test these conditions, right, the conditions that something is valid. It's basically the hard condition is basically that it corresponds to some positive semi-definite matrix, and I feel like eventually we would be able to so the dream in some sense is basically that both these steps will be kind of basically automatic, that you would have at least in principle some finite computation that you can run on the machine, and it will tell you it will first come up with the pseudo distribution, because there isn't really any creative choice to come up with it, and then it will tell you if it's valid or not, it will tell you what's the best parameter that it can do it, and it will kind of tell you. It would be, we obviously can do it for every particular input length, but what I would like is that one finite computation that will give you the answer for all input lengths. And I think that this should be possible, but we haven't got there yet. So but this, by the way, there is a setting in which this a dream very similar to this one has been realized, and this is something Pablo will talk about. I don't know if next week or the week after.
There's a talk also next week.
What?
There's also a talk and a great one. I'll
cover all this. Okay. So basically, Pablo will talk about utilizing symmetry in so basically how do you make a problem that is potentially infinite into finite, and you use it both to actually say solve things in practice faster and also to answer basic questions in extremal combinatorics, and so there are cases where this dream has been realized. Here there is it still hasn't been realized because this is kind of a problem that is not symmetric point wise but symmetric in distribution, and we'll see what this means. So but I feel this is only a matter of time, and I hope maybe one of you guys will be the person to do it. So so basically this is it for Bayesian things, so I think we can now take a break and then move to actual planted cliques. So let's... Whoa. Okay, give it full 10 minutes. we start?
Yeah.
Okay. So... Okay, so the planted clique problem. So we define, G and half is just random graph. Ergosh, when you random graph, every edge is a probability half, and G and half omega is like a random plus omega b. And yes?
Sorry, it's like, so the omega b sort of union with the edges that are in, so some of those edges might already have been there.
Yes. So you basically select a random set of size omega, and then you add the edges that are not there already. So in expectation, you'll add something like half times omega juice. So, so this is the planted clique problem, and the problem, and there are kind of for any of those kind of average case problems, there are typically three variants. So, is the kind of decision variant, distinguish between these two guys. There is the search variant, in the case that it's planted, find it, and there is the refutation or certification variant, in the case that it's random, certify that there is no such clique. And generally speaking, the decision is easier than either one of those, because you know, if you can solve the search, you can distinguish. If you can do the refutation, you can distinguish, and these two are incomparable. For many average case problems, including the planted clique, basically, all the algorithms, we don't know of any better algorithms for any one of the variants, so we kind of don't really distinguish between them too much. We kind of believe they're all, that as omega ranges, clearly the problem becomes easier as omega becomes bigger, and we kind of believe that the threshold in which it becomes easier is the same for all three problems. And My motivation for planted clique is that it's going to teach us a lot about sum of squares, and it will force us, doing this lower bound will kind of force us to develop some new techniques. But people have been very interested in the planted clique problem for their own reasons. It's kind of arisen in all sorts of domains, and there are references in the notes, applications, which most of them, by the way, you know, most of them are these kind of things where I, you know, searched and I have some sense that I think these things are related, but probably if you actually follow the reference, you'll find out this thing is completely unrelated. So please don't follow the references. but there are definitely papers in all sorts of domains where you'd have similar sounding terms in their abstracts. Okay, so what is the theorem that we want to prove? Is the following. So basically, okay. So. So there is an exercise to develop in the notes how to do it when omega is some constant times square root n. Let me give you some just quick suggestion why square root n should be about the right amount, or at least an easy thing to do, at least for the refutation problem, and it has to do exactly with your question. So if you look at the total number of edges, then so the total number of edges here, it's right. So the total number of edges here, it's basically normal with expectation like n choose 2 over 2, and you know, standard deviation, say variance n choose 2 or n choose 2. Let me just write it, take out n squared. And the number of things here is like, again, n choose 2 over 2 plus half times omega choose 2, and the same standard deviation. And we can see that when omega is roughly square root n, this becomes like a constant times the standard deviation. Like the standard deviation is O of n, and this is like omega squared. So when omega is some constant times square root n, this becomes like a standard deviation. So you should be able to distinguish just by counting the total number of edges with some you know, constant advantage over half. The bigger omega is, like, 100 times square root n, the advantage becomes actually, like, the probability becomes better and better. And there are, but there are some ways to amplify it, and basically looking at the spectrum of this adjacency matrix of G, you can get both better probabilities and also actually recover the pattern clique. So basically, we knew how to do it when omega is square root n, and the main question is, could we do it better? And one evidence that was that this is not the case was for Feige and Bartgammer. I don't remember, like maybe 2004. I'm not sure exactly when two. That's like two, some number, and then they showed that basically LS plus hierarchy in time n to the O of d does it basically works for when omega is something like n over 2 to the d. And notice that basically when d is log n, then it basically this becomes meaningless, and indeed when d is log n, we can basically when in time n to the log n, we can O of log n, we can solve this problem, because a random graph will have with very high probability will not have a clique of size larger than say 2 log n. So if we search over all 3 log n sets and we find a clique, then we know for sure we are in this case, and in fact it's not so hard to solve the search problem in this case. So in time n of O log n, we can solve this problem, but for every, basically this thing, for every constant d, it only gives us square root n. And basically the result I want to talk about today is this work with Hopkins
Kellner, Cotine, Moitra, and Potecin. This is actually a result that was just presented in a Fox conference last week. And this is that basically for every constant D and for every epsilon, if omega is less than n to the half minus epsilon, then there exists a degree D pseudo-distribution mu such that, you know, expectation x, I, x, j, then, you know, with high probability over g, over a random graph, there exists a pseudo-distribution mu such that, you know, this is zero for every I that is not in J, and the expectation of some xi that is. Okay? So this basically says that sum of squares algorithm does not do significantly better, you know, basically does n to the half minus little of one, also in polynomial time. And in the lecture notes, there is actually the exact dependence between epsilon and beta. And basically, so this is the theorem, and I think what's kind of interesting here is that it's also this construction that somehow teaches us something in the analysis, which of which we'll see some of it, but not all of it. Okay, so is the statement of the theorem clear? Yes? Okay, so now we just have to prove it. Okay. So let's look at basically the first approach, kind of the classical approach to proving this theorem. And this is the way these theorems usually were proven in the past was basically to say, well, you know, this is, I didn't even tell you what LS plus is. Maybe I can actually tell you what LS plus is. LS plus is basically, it's like SOS, but you know, the expectation that p squared larger than zero is only for linear p. So you define degree d pseudo distributions. You give the moments for all you give the moments for all degree d polynomials, but you only require this non-negativity condition for linear things. Am I confusing things, or is this LS plus?
I think you need more.
Maybe you need some kind of marginalization. You need that these things kind of make sense. Like if you have a strong constraint. So in LS plus, if there is something that's supposed to be, if you know, if you have some p that is supposed to be zero, then you require that the expectation of pq is zero for every q. And I think that allows you to somehow connect the low degree moments with the yes, but I think that basically this is the most important part, and the natural thing which actually had worked with other sum of squares low bounds in the past is basically to say, well, maybe this thing is already PSD. And this thing, maybe this pseudo distribution was very, very simple. So that would be a very nice thing if it was. So the FK, let's call them the FK moments, are the following thing. It's basically, I can also call them the hard So basically, they said the following. They said, you know, expectation of XS. Expectation of SS would be, you know, essentially omega. Okay, it would be zero if S is not a clique, right? If S, now I look, think of S as kind of a small set. Think of S as like a set of four vertices. So, if a set of four vertices is not a clique, then the probability that it is inside the planted clique is zero, right? Everyone agrees, right? A clique does not contain a non-clique inside, right? So this is a hard constraint. We better kind of like every idiot knows that this should be the case. And then basically the other things we say, okay, if S is a clique, then we give it we basically say, you know, it's basically with equal probability, you know, it will fall in that inside thing, except you kind of need to, you know, because these guys are zero, you kind of need to increase these guys by something to make everything sum up to omega. And the right thing, it's some constant, it doesn't really matter what it is. Think of S as a constant, so it doesn't really matter what it is. Something like this, at least 2 to the S choose 2. You can ignore that constant, it's not important. So basically, it's like omega, if S is not a clique, you give it zero. If S is a clique, you give it omega over n to the power of the size of S. Right, so this basically says, I'm satisfying the hard constraints, I'm not an idiot. I know that if something is not a clique, then I give it probability zero, but I don't know anything about else, about nothing. If you tell me a vertex, what's the probability of it? I tell you, well, omega over n. You give me two vertices connected by an edge, I give you, well, omega squared over n squared. So that's kind of these kind of moments, these hard constraint moments, and these kind of are very similar to these moments that we've seen in the Grigoriev proof for 3XO, if you remember that. So there, basically, we looked at a set of variables, and we say, well, if we can obviously show that it, you know, if it's just a small combination of a small number of our equations, then it's clearly, you know, the moments need to respect that. And other, we basically say it behaves like uniform, so the moments were like as if it, everything was uniform. In that case, it was like equal probability being 0, 1. So let's just see. I mean, I told you that these moments actually do work for the degree equal 2k. So let's see why they work for the degree equals 2k. So right, because I said that they do satisfy this condition for degree equals 2, and let's see why they work. So basically, let's look at this matrix. You know, expectation of xi, xj, according to these moments. So this matrix is basically the following thing. It's, you know, the probability that every individual vertex is in this thing is omega over n. So expectation of xi squared, which is the same as expectation of xi because we are 0, 1 variables, it's omega over n. And then plus, we get here, omega, you know, this constant which I'll ignore, omega over n squared times the adjacency matrix of the graph. So let's make sure that we understand why this is the case, right? So if we take xi and xj, then if I equals to j, then we're looking at expectation of xi squared, which is the same as expectation of xi. It's the probability that I is in the clique, omega over n, right? So on the diagonal here, we're going to have omega over n. And if we look at I and j that are different, then if they are a non-edge, they get zero. And if they are an edge, they get omega squared over n squared, times some constant, which doesn't matter. So this is what we get, right? Omega over n plus omega over n squared times the adjacency matrix of the graph. Okay, now, the graph is a random graph. And there is a general theorem that says, you know, we actually know very well how the spectrum looks of a random graph like that. So basically, it's going to look like this.
there is going to be one eigenvalue that is like n or n over 2 or something that corresponds to the all ones thing, but it's a positive eigenvalue, we don't worry about it so much. And then all the other eigenvalues will be kind of in the range minus square root n plus square root n. So in particular, what we know is that lambda mean g is going to be larger than some constant times square root minus square root n. So if we want this to be TST, what we need is that omega over n is at least square root n times omega squared over n squared. And the way we should we can write this is that omega over n times omega over square root n. So and this is fine when this is fine when omega is smaller than square root. Okay, so this is very, very simple, and we're going to get to things that are more complicated. So if you don't understand this, this is an excellent time to stop me and ask a question.
There's also the thing
of, what?
Like the set the size
one. Right, yeah, I guess here I'm trying to, I'm just proving the, I'm just looking at this 2x2 matrix, and not looking at, you know, the full moment matrix has some other part that kind of corresponds to, not sure what it corresponds to. I think this is basically, like in the two cases, this is basically the matrix you want to prove that it's BSD.
And also like for the individual pattern of the marginal individual.
Ah, okay. Like a constant, like the, which is basically constant in this case, I think. Yes. So I think you're right that maybe to prove that this matrix, the actual matrix that it needs to be PSD is slightly bigger, but this is really the heart of this matrix. So people understand why this matrix is going to be PSD. Okay. So basically this this works for. And then basically there was in 2013, Mecca and Wigdelson, maybe in 2013, they published a paper that basically gave a proof that, you know, FK moments are actually satisfy, you know, expectation p squared for every p degree of b over 2. So basically that would mean that they are valid pseudo-distribution. And basically we kind of, why did I put proof, you know, in quotation marks? Because we kind of already know that if we believe SOS is optimal, then this cannot be true, right? Because we can these moments are silly. They don't adjust, say, for vertices of higher degree to give a higher probability. Let me, as a parenthetical remark, let me say that if you actually, you know, go and look at the paper, you will see that I'm lying, because there is some small adjustment that they do adjust a little bit, but they don't adjust aggressively enough. So in a sense, it's, you can ignore their adjustment. So you could basically, you could win, you know, you, in polynomial time, you could play against these FK moments and win bets against them, because basically, they don't do enough of an adjustment, and of course the amount you win is important, and we'll see these moments obviously when omega is small enough, in which case you can still win against them, but probably like a small amount, and why small is considered negligible, it's again like a Very good question, which I don't completely understand. But basically, so these moments are not. So these moments. So we kind of have some moral reasons why we believe there is something off with these moments. But let's see why they thought. They actually had a very nice proof. Unfortunately, it had a bad, but they had a very nice proof why these moments should be true, should be PSD. And the crucial component in this proof was a nice concentration inequality that, again, is unfortunately false, but it's kind of interesting to understand what could have been the case. They said the following thing. So here is a theorem, which is the following. Suppose you have some p from, say, plus minus 1 to the n, two matrices, say, plus minus 1 to, I don't know, let's call it m, two matrices that are n by n. So you have some polynomial p like that, so it's a kind of matrix-valued polynomial. And let's just assume that expectation of p of x is 0. By this I mean it's the 0 matrix, right? It's a matrix-valued polynomial. And how would you define the variance of p? So somehow natural way to define the variance of p would be, expectation of px squared, or like, because we are talking about matrices, px, px transpose. So it somehow seems like that you would, it would make sense that, you know, the probability that p of x is at most k standard deviation away is 1 minus, like, 2 to the minus k squared. But you have to lose something. Okay, so first of all, you have to lose something like n to the O of D or something like that, some polynomial factor, and n or a poly, some kind of polynomial factor, I think you have to lose it, say n to the O of D or something like that. And the second thing is that we even know from the scalar case is that we kind of need to lose your D, where D is the degree of this polynomial. But this seems like a very natural thing to be true. And we know that if D equals 1 for matrix valued polynomials, it is known to be true. Okay, first of all, before we ask even if it's true or false, what does it even mean? Okay, so notice that I did something very fishy. What is var P? What kind of object is it? It's a matrix, right? So what is the square root of a matrix mean? Right, if a PSD matrix, so basically what we know, if it's a PSD matrix, it has the form, if M has the, it has the form, people usually write it like L transpose lambda 1, lambda n, L, then square root m is simply like this L transpose, and all of these are non-negative, square root lambda 1, square root lambda n. So the variance is a non-negative, is a PSD matrix, so you can take a square root of it. And when we say that, say, A is smaller than B, what we mean here is in a spectral sense, that V transpose AV is smaller than V transpose BV for every V. Okay, so this is what it means for one matrix to be smaller than another one. Right, so now at least we can make this statement make sense. And the interesting thing is that for D equal if these things were scalar, the actual numbers, this is known for every D. if these things were matrices, this is known for D equals 1, for linear polynomials. And for scalars, you know that you have to lose this D in the exponent, by the way, so instead of natural thing. So basically, they conjectured that there is a common generalization of these things, very natural conjecture. They saw the even have a proof. But unfortunately, this is false. And they show that this theorem implies that these moments are PSD. But unfortunately, this theorem is false. I'm not going to work out why it's false. Just I'll tell you like the example. So the example is very simple. Just define P of x in x x transpose. So just a quadratic polynomial. So x is say and think of x is in plus minus one to the n. So we minus make it mean zero minus I. So now you can do the calculations, and it turns out that this thing is false. If you're interested, I think you learn more by just actually it's a good exercise. So exercise. Prove this violates this theorem. This example, I think, was shown to given by Bayesian. But now we'll see. But this example just shows that their theorem is false. It doesn't show that the moments are themselves are not PSD. But now we'll see that these moments are not PSD, and you kind of know what's the reason that the moments should not be PSD. The reason is that these moments kind of don't adjust for statistics. And now we'll kind of see why not adjusting for statistics makes things problematic. So this might be kind of a very roundabout way to for me why don't I just show you the proof of the theorem rather than showing you how not to prove this theorem? But I think it actually teaches us something and it kind of justifies why we need to take this kind of Bayesian approach and why we don't just take this the first moments that come to our mind. So I hope you bear with me this little bit of a roundabout way. So here is a theorem. The FK moments, there exists a degree 2 polynomial P such that expectation of P squared is negative in FK moments. Okay, so these moments are not PSD, and the proof works by the as follows. We find Q such that expectation of Q. So we find Q of degree 4 such that expectation of Q in any actual distribution is much larger than the expectation of Q in FK distribution. And then we somehow find a Q in which we can kind of make money off betting against the FK moments. And it will be a variant of what we've already seen. And then we'll convert it we'll transform this Q into a polynomial that is squared, and somehow this kind of Bayesian viewpoint allows you to come up with this polynomial this polynomial that it's not so hard to see it once you get it, but somehow Megan Mendelssohn missed it, and the reason they missed it, I
I think it's because when you're not looking at these things with this kind of Bayesian viewpoint, it's kind of hard to see.
And okay, so what is this Q?
Let me write Q of X will be sum I 1 to n, sum j connected to I xi minus sum j not connected to I xj, so xj, all that to the 4. And we also write, you know, can write the sum qi to the 4. We'll define this part at qi, it will be useful for us at some point. Okay, so if x is okay, so let me make a claim. If x is 1s for omega clique, then u of x is larger than 1.
Does anyone see why this claim is true? Yes.
Yes.
The number of connected vertices that are in the for each xi. So you can think of it if x is if x corresponds to a set, then for every I you take the number of neighbors inside the set minus the number of non-neighbors inside the set, and you raise it to the power 4. Okay. So can you see why this claim is true? Why Q will be at least omega to the 5? Yes. So can you say?
For vertices that are not in the clique, that thing is about 0. Because the number of neighbors are not in the same clique.
In any case, it's not negative, right? Because it's a fourth power.
Yeah. And the ones that are in the clique, it's about an omega advantage of the neighbors to not neighbors.
Right.
You take that to the fourth, and then there are about omega guys in the clique.
Yes. So in some sense, right, if I is in the clique, if you think about it, this is exactly going to be omega, right? Because for the guys that are not in the clique, this is zero. Like all the guys that are for each xj, they are omega guys or omega minus one or something, that the neighbors of this guy that are in the clique, all of them are connected to it. So you and everyone that's not connected to it is definitely getting zero here. So you get your omega to the 4, and there are omega guys to the in the clique, so you get omega to the 5. And for other i's, it's at least non-negative, so it's going to be at least omega to the 5. Maybe omega times omega minus 1 to the 4, let's not deal with such minor issues. Okay, so if x is in the clique, then we get this thing. But, so this is... So we have proven this, and claim two is that if you look at the expectation according to the Feige-Krautgammer moments of Q, then it is going to be at most something like O of n omega squared. And I'll soon do the calculation, but just note that if omega is larger than n to the 1/3, then beat. And basically, you know, if I made bets on what is going to be the value of Q of X, then basically, if I sold the Q stock then basically a fake quant gamma would give an idiotically small price for this stock. The stock is guaranteed to give us always a return of omega to the 5, but fake quant gamma would only give it like n times omega squared. And indeed, in a very non-trivial work of Hopkins, Kotari, Potecin, and I think Deshpande Montanari also had the same result. They showed that actually these moments are PSD when omega is less than n to the 1 factor. So let me prove this thing. So basically this already shows that there is something off with these moments, right? They give the wrong prices. But let's show why this is the case. So basically, can people see this part of the board? You guys over there, is it visible? For you? Okay. So let's understand what's going to be. And the main point is the following. So let's just look at particular by linearity. We can just understand what phase one we will give for some particular qi to the 4. Right, so this is basically sum over J1, J2, J3, J4. And I'm going to ignore constants. So we're going to get basically omega over n to the size of J1, J2, J3, J4, and then I'm going to get minus one to the number of non-edges I from J1, J2, J3, J4, counted with multiplicities. Right, so I expanded this, right? So I expand this, so I kind of sum up over all J1, J2, J3, J4, and you get kind of a minus one sign if you're not connected to I, and plus one if you are connected to I. We only get these for guys that are cliques, right? And we kind of know that our moments for guys that are cliques, they give us omega over n to the size of this clique. So we're going to get we're going to get this thing, right? So basically the idea is the following. Let's separate it into two cases. Like let's say look at the case where J1, J2, J3, J4 is full size. There are basically then we get like omega over n to the 4, and then we get the sum over all these guys, which and plus minus 1. And the point is the following: this is a random graph, right? So the question of whether J1, J2, J3, J4 is a clique has nothing to do with I, right? So we can imagine that we selected all this graph, and then we selected who is going to be neighbor of I completely independently. And what it means is that these plus minus ones are basically like random things. So they are about n to the 4, n to the 4 divided by some constant, but basically n to the 4 guys like that. And if we are going to sum up these with plus minus 1, we are going to get roughly n squared. So this contribution will be roughly n omega over n, omega over n to the 4 times n squared. And then there is going to be the guys where these are only two of these guys, then the sign will always be one, so you get n squared times omega over n squared. And you can see that actually this guy will dominate. So basically what we're going to get is that this expectation is going to be O of omega squared, and since Q is the sum of n of those guys, we get n times omega squared. Okay? So that shows that we can win against these Feige quark gamma moments, but it doesn't immediately show that we can that they are not sum of squares, they are not a PSD. But now we can show that. So now we find we'll define our polynomial. So how will I do it? The question is really, where will I do it? Let me do it here. So here is proof of the theorem. Which theorem? This one. Proof of the theorem, we're going to define, we're going to select some typical I, let's just take typical I such that the expectation of Qi to the power is what we calculated above there, essentially omega squared. I'm ignoring constants all over. And we're going to select P to be Xi minus C times Qi squared. Okay, and I'll choose C in a second to see, to make sure that it satisfies the... let's compute. So now I want to show that expectation of P squared, that I can choose some value C, that expectation of P squared will be negative. So what is expectation of P squared? Expectation of P squared is going to be expectation of Xi squared minus C. Again, I'm ignoring the constants, expectation of Xi Qi squared plus expectation of Qi to the 4. A times C squared, okay, so plus C squared expectation of Qi to the 4. Right? Okay, so now let's look at the two positive things. We get omega over n, right? This expectation plus c squared and omega squared. And now minus c, and now let's compute. What is expectation of xi qi squared? So expectation of xi qi squared, so we have to remember what was qi. So this is the following, expectation of Q, xi qi squared is the sum over all j, j prime, such that I, j, j prime are cliques. Say omega over n cubed times minus 1, the number of non-edges from I to j, j prime. Right, I did the same thing as above. Now, if I, j, j prime are cliques, how many non-edges do we have from I to j and j prime? Right? So if you have a clique, I, j, j prime, so how many non-edges do you have between I and j and I and j prime? Zero, right? It's a clique, right? Right, so basically once I did this expression, which I basically did, right, so maybe I should have done it slower. So I just basically, I looked at xi xj, xj prime, and so we look at expectation of xi, xj, xj prime, and we know it zeroes out when ij, j prime is not a clique, right? So basically, this is always going to be, right, this is always going to be plus one. So this is basically just n, there are n squared such guys, so n squared omega over n cubed, so we get this value omega cubed over n. Now I think I can just guess what I need to do. So now if I look at C, so now basically, so this is like omega cubed over n. So this is like omega, so here we get like C times omega cubed over n. Now I just need to show that I can make C, choose a C such that this will be more negative than these two guys are positive. And basically, what I'm going to choose is, I'm going to choose C, which is some kind of epsilon times omega over n. I think that was the right choice. I mean, this is just, you know, to balance things out. So you get here, so then you get here like omega to the 4 times epsilon, and here you get the omega to the 4 over n squared, but times epsilon squared. And so this dies out, and this kills this as long as omega to the 4 over n squared is larger than omega over n, which is exactly when omega cubed is larger than n. The same condition as before. Okay, so these calculations are a little bit boring, but so if you didn't exactly follow them, that's fine. The point is the general scheme of things. We saw that there is something off in the Feige Krautgammer moments, and then we found something off in the way that we could efficiently bet against it and win. And then we can convert it into an actual polynomial whose square gets a negative expectation. And then once we get this actual polynomial, we can fix it. And basically, this was a work of, I'm confusing the references, but maybe this was the work of, okay, no, so this was the work of, I think, maybe this was a different reference, but Hopkins, Kotari, Potechin, Gavendra, and Schramm, they basically did all this work to fix, they basically looked at this polynomial, they fixed, you know, fk moments, and they get, and they show that for degree equals 4, you can get like square root n, roughly. Omega square root n. But their fix is kind of was very ad hoc, and it was kind of clear that for this fix doesn't work for degree equals 6. So you could basically keep trying to find polynomials and fix polynomials, find polynomials and fix polynomials. But what we'll do after the break is we'll kind of say, you know, let's take the guesswork out of it. We are going to make this in some sense a condition that you cannot we're going to make it a constraint that there is no way to bet against this thing and win. And then we will see that this basically tells us what the moments are going to be. Yes?
How did we come up with that polynomial? Once we found some kind of test that looks different in the algorithm than in the two ways, how did we actually come up with that?
How did we come up with what?
So once we found this cube,
yes,
which looks different in the two cases, in that case, like, is there some
So I don't know if a principled way, like we kind of eventually stumbled upon it. So both, you know, on the polynomial, and then actually John Keller was the person that found the polynomial, and then, you know, so initially the polynomial that's simply off, and then, the you know, finding a way to a square that's negative. In some sense, the somewhat more principled way is the following thing. You kind of look at this claim, right? You made this claim that this should be omega to the pi. And what you do is you actually, I mean, it's a simple claim. So you actually look at the proof of this claim and realize that it's a sum of squares proof. So any valid sum of squares pseudo distribution will actually satisfy that the expectation of Q needs to be at least omega to the pi. So that way, if you kind of do it in this general way, you might not exactly maybe need to go a little bit higher degree, but it's not very hard, right? Because it's kind of a very simple proof, right? That if it was an actual distribution, it needs to be omega to the pi, and because it's a simple proof and doesn't use the probabilistic method, then it's also is going to be captured by sum of squares, and therefore you'd better if a pseudo distribution doesn't satisfy it, then it's going to be invalid. So that's kind of the more principled way to do this. So basically what we're going to see after the break is how do we define the pseudo distribution basically by, so in some sense, kind of management buzzwords, we want to transform a challenge into an opportunity. So basically what we want to say is, you know, we can keep looking at this as a bad thing, that, you know, we keep finding these polynomials, fixing these polynomials, finding this polynomial, fixing this polynomial. But rather than that, we say, okay, we just take all, we kind of define the pseudo distribution implicitly by saying it has to be good for all these polynomials, in the sense that you couldn't bet against it. And once we make this requirement, then we basically, once we kind of make this requirement, then we basically are in a good shape, because we at least we remove the creativity. We know what the pseudo distribution has to be, and now we just have to prove that it's PSV. So let's take a 7 minute break. Okay, so now so in some sense everything we did before was was how not to prove this theorem. Now I want to talk to you about how to prove this theorem, and for the I'm not going to be able to show you the full proof, but I hope that I'm going to give you enough information so that if you now go to the paper, the full proof will not look as scary as it might be otherwise, and at some point we might also have like better written notes on the PSDNS proof that I think when we get to the point where I believe the notes are better than the paper, then I'll post them. But at the moment, I think the paper is actually right now the best source for it. Okay. So basically, there is a notion of arbitrage, or a Dutch book. Basically, it's a strategy to win against a pseudo distribution. So what is suppose you have some f that maps, you know, graphs and cliques into real numbers, then, you know, if an expectation over gx that comes from the Planck clique, fgx is different
different than expectation over G say from the plugin clique pseudo distribution FG.
In some sense, something is off here. You can kind of use this as you can basically you know that say suppose this is bigger than you know, so suppose that the truth thing is bigger than this, then you know that on average this is pricing FG too low, right? So basically, if we wanted, so basically, if we wanted the condition of our pseudo distribution to satisfy no, so if we wanted this condition to satisfy no arbitrage, then we want this to satisfy this one. Okay, so so this is a natural condition, but basically if you require it for all functions, it's basically the only thing that will satisfy it is the actual distribution that's, you know, actually supported on the clique. So so we're going to restrict it to so we then want to say no efficient, which basically say that for every f that is simple and in fact because we are not going to we believe that it's not going to be able to distinguish between the Plantar distribution on the right hand side, we don't believe that this actually will matter much because otherwise we'll have a way to distinguish between the two guys, so we'll, on the right-hand side, we'll actually use the completely random distribution. So basically, let's call this equation star, and we want star to hold for every f such that degree, you know, f is a function in g and x, such that, you know, degree x of f is at most some d, and degree and the g variable of f is at most some tau. And we'll choose some tau, will be another constant, some large constant, will depend on d later. And basically the idea is that now we make this condition. And if you think about this condition, it's basically say if suppose we think of the pseudo distribution as an unknown, right? So for every particular f, we can compute this thing. It's just a number, and so this is basically, and this thing is basically going to be just a linear equation on the pseudo distribution. So basically this is a linear constraint on what the pseudo distribution should satisfy, and we are going to put all these linear constraints on the pseudo distribution, and then and then it turns out that basically doesn't it's essentially completely determines the pseudo distribution, and all we are left is to prove that something that satisfies all these linear constraints also satisfies the PSD constraint.
Yes. So what's the problem of tau? Is there somehow, why is it polynomial dimension?
So so we need, in some sense we cannot allow functions that depend arbitrarily complicated way on g, because think of the function that fg of x is the constant function 1 if g has a large clique, and the constant function 0 if g doesn't have a large clique. So this is a function that has degree 0 in x but large degree in g. But it obviously can distinguish between the two cases. So we somehow want to only allow kind of simple functions, simple functions that ones that can be efficiently be computed on G. And our definition is to just basically restrict to low degree functions in G.
But but that's restriction on what, or somehow, or what changes if I allow tau to be very large?
So if you allow tau to be very large, then you will not be able to, you'll definitely not be able to satisfy it in some sense. This will not make say any efficient. So if you allow tau to be very large, then in particular it will allow this function, right? So think of fg of x equals 1 if the largest clique in g is at least n to the 1 quarter and 0 otherwise. Right, so this has degree 0 in x, degree some large degree in g.
So I guess I'm trying to understand, is that an assumption on the solution that I'm using? Is that an assumption?
So this is kind of like, we want to make this requirement only for easy to compute, right? So right now we're making this requirement. It doesn't make sense for us to make it for all f, because then it would not be computationally, it would basically require the pseudo distribution to be the actual distribution. So we only make it for low degree, and these are clearly things that, like low degree, if it's low degree on G, these are clearly things, it's kind of a minimal requirement in some sense, because clearly a polynomial time strategy for every FG that where G experiences a low degree polynomial in G does correspond to a low degree, to an efficient strategy. So, in some sense, we want to ensure that for all efficient strategies, or at least all efficient strategies in this framework, you cannot win by betting against the pseudo distribution.
But this tau you will instantiate it later.
Yes. So we will instantiate it later. It will be some kind of function of D. One of the things that's there is kind of a long kind of a pretty wide range of tau where it will not exactly matter what it is. Like it's it needs to be sufficiently larger than D, so things are PSD, and not too large, so things don't completely break. But between that, it can it has kind of a lot of room to go. And so we'll instantiate it later. And in some sense, so we want this condition, and now the way we'll achieve this condition is actually going to be very simple. So in some sense, we are going to do the following thing. So consider new planted. Gx is just, you know, the probability of Gx on the planted distribution. And what we're going to do is we're going to say mu is going to be simply mu of Gx is basically what going to be mu planted, where we restrict to at most degree t, d, and tau as a polynomial in the variable of gx. So this is the pseudo distribution that we're going to use. So we basically take this Planck distribution, we think of it as a polynomial, we just truncate to its low order moments, low order monomials, and we use that. And notice that there is something kind of incredibly weird about what we are doing, which is the following. Like mu planted is a distribution that gives zero probability for all graphs that are not in the for all graphs that are not in the support of the planted distribution. And but our mu is going to give like basically is going to not be able to distinguish between the planted distribution and random graphs. So it turns out that somehow truncating thing, basically truncating to this low order monomial, somehow loses this distinction. So this is basically our definition. In fact, later we might slightly modify this thing because this will kind of somewhat satisfy the constraint, but not exactly. And one claim so is claim that mu satisfies star. So basically, when we have defined things in this way, we are going to satisfy star. And the reason is the following. So we're going to look at mu, right? The right hand side is like basically the left, right? So the right hand side is mu, right? The pseudo expectation here is, right? It's like, maybe we should write it more slowly. So we would say, okay, so right hand side is sum over all g, sum over all gx, u gx, f gx. Left hand side is sum over all gx, u planted, gx, fgx. Right? And now the way we think about it is that the right hand side is like, you know, mu dot fg, and the left hand side is mu dot fg plus the high degree part, mu high. So mu is the low degree part of mu is the low degree part of the planted, and mu high is the high degree part of with fg. But then we basically just use the fact that if you project to low degree polynomial, then this is going to be the fg has at most degree tau in g, and at most degree x in and at most degree d in x, and here every monomial has higher degree in one of them, so this is going to be zero. Okay, because this is going to be orthogonal, right? This is the part, mu high is the part that's kind of orthogonal to all these kind of polynomials. Okay, but if you did, you could also define simply, in some sense we could just define mu to be the thing that satisfies these constraints. But it's kind of a very clean definition to do it this way. Okay, so so it's now it's going to also be useful for us to expand this mu in the parity basis. So let's write. So we can write the following thing. So we define okay, this is the thing that somehow okay. So let's define if T is a subset of n. N choose 2. So T is a subset of potential edges, then we define chi T of G to be the product of E in T 1 minus 2 G E. Okay, so basically chi T is a function that takes a graph and outputs either plus 1 or minus 1, where it takes the product on these edges for minus 1 if there is an edge and plus 1 if there isn't an edge. Okay? And please tell me if I don't do it, I'll try to keep it. I'll try to use T for subsets of edges and S for subsets of vertices. probably there is a better kind of notation to use completely different types of letters. I'll think about it at some point when we try to, but for today, let's do that, okay? So, and it's somehow we're always working here with functions that take these two kind of variables, the variables that are edges, like the graph, variables that are vertices. So, try to keep in mind which is which. Right, so if we think about, right, so now let's think about the following. Let's look at expectation of XS. This is as a function of G, right? This is basically, for every particular S, for every S, which is a subset of vertices, a small subset of vertices, expectation of XS is a function of G, right? So we can write it, so we can write it as a polynomial. We can write it as sum over T expectation of the Fourier coefficient, which the right way to write it is. So this is just a notation, but this is the coefficient that if you write it as a polynomial, if you write this as a polynomial, express it as a sum of these chi t's, this is the coefficient corresponding to t. Okay? So this is basically the Fourier representation of this thing. And now you can actually compute this. And this is like an exercise that the Fourier coefficient, it's actually not that hard to compute. Okay, so we kind of truncated things so that basically the Fourier coefficient corresponding to t, you can prove that it's going to be you can prove that it's going to be roughly omega over n. Omega over n to the power, v of t is the vertices that touch the edges t, union s. So this is a calculation, and you can do it. And in fact, this doesn't matter much, but it's somehow a little bit convenient. We'll then do it this way. So this doesn't change by a lot. It's kind of slightly different truncation, but it's, that satisfies the hard constraints better. And another, if you wanted, you can also invert the things. You can use, instead of this being an exercise and this being the definition, you can do it somehow the other way around. You can make this the definition, and then prove the claim from this definition. Okay, so kind of choosing poison. So if you want to be, we can kind of make this the definition of a pseudo distribution. So let's now just take it this on granted. So the heart of the whole thing. Okay, so in some sense, this pseudo distribution was motivated by Bayesian considerations. But at this point, you can kind of forget how I came up with it. If you simply want to see the proof of this theorem, what you want me to is to basically show this main lemma. The main lemma is the following. If we define MG to be the matrix, which is like N to the D over 2 by N to the D over 2, such that M G point I J is the pseudo expectation of xi union j for the graph g. Maybe I'll write it this way. Then with high probability, n is PSD, assuming you know the right parameters, right? So there is, well, the right way to say it is that for every epsilon n d, there exists a tau such that if omega is n to the half minus epsilon, then this. Okay, so this is basically what we have to prove. Okay, so do people agree that basically if we prove the main lemma, then we have proven the theorem? Okay. So this is really the heart of the matter. It's always the heart of the matter, right? Proving this PSDS condition. And I don't like, let me say, right now, I don't like the proof that's in the paper. I feel like there should be a different proof. I still don't know what's the right book proof. And I'll tell you the two possible approaches. Maybe they could be merged at some point. How I think like a clean proof that's not like, you know, 50 pages should look like. So it's one thing I would have loved to be able to prove along the line. So here is somehow a dream proof. So maybe we want to prove the following thing. We want to prove that we would want to basically say, assume for sake of contradiction that for most or for many G's there is degree at most d over 2 poly fg such that expectation g of fg squared. So this is degree less than d over 2 in the variable, less than 0. Then the hope would be to somehow do some kind of case analysis. You would say if, you know, if degree with g of fg is less than tau, then we're kind of done. The reason is the following. If f this function has small degree in g, then we know that this thing fg is squared or less than tau over 2. So if this thing has less you know, if this thing had degree small degree, then we know that this expectation. So we somehow would get that if this is negative, then we would get that somehow expectation over and this happens for many g's, then it will be the case that somehow if we take expectation over g, it still should be negative, but then this will violate star because we know that in this distribution, definitely if this is an actual distribution, so expectation of something squared here is non-negative. So somehow it should be the, like if this degree is small, we should be able to conclude. And otherwise, maybe we would say that kind of fg is kind of random. And we would somehow argue that it's it kind of somehow it cannot be correlated with the large or the particular the eigenspace of this matrix that is particularly small. So in some sense, we would want to say it's kind of like a randomness versus structure partition. If you've heard this name, that we would kind of want to say that we take this matrix and we would say that its extreme eigenvalues, the interesting eigenvalues, correspond to have eigenvectors that are low degree polynomials in G. And I think something like that might be true, but I don't know how to prove things this way. So this is not how the proof goes. And so this is one open problem. Now let me say about how the proof actually goes. Unfortunately, it's more complicated. Okay, so I think at this point, I need to. I basically have this. Think of it. At this point, let's just treat this as definition. And I need to prove the main lemma. Okay, and forget about everything else. So basically, we have a random matrix, and yes.
Sorry, could you show the so if we were in the case where FG is random environment?
So yeah, no, you're not immediately, but you would hope to kind of show that somehow a random vector will never cause you a problem here. Like that might be easy to kind of analyze to show that most. That if there are negative eigenvalues, they are kind of like a low-dimensional subspace or something like that. So there is something special about them. So you would need to do something, but in some sense, you could hope that. So that basically now we need to prove this main lemma. And let me kind of give you a high-level idea of how the proof goes. So the we're basically trying to prove that this random matrix is a positive semi-definite, and there are tons and tons of tons and tons of results on random matrix. Like if you know, there are books and books about random matrix theory. So you might even think that at this point we should be done. Basically, just find a book. And just quote the right theorem, and maybe that's true. I just haven't been able to find the book. And let me tell you, like, the main kind of reason why at least most of the work on random matrix theory is not cannot be used directly in this case. And the main issue is the following thing: like M is basically a map from 0, 1 to the n choose 2 into n to the d by n to the d matrices. So, and we are thinking of it as a random variable, we choose the input at random. So basically, there are, about n squared bits of randomness and about n to the d or n to the 2d. Matter of scaling, maybe I should write it n to the d, n squared bits of randomness and n to the d bits of output. In particular, what it means is that these entries of this matrix are not independent of each other. There is not enough randomness from them to be independent. So most of random matrix theory, at least as far as I know, is it can be arbitrary distributions over every entry, but they typically assume that the entries are independent. And this dependence can really screw things over. Yes?
Have we found G from one of our normal distributions from before?
Yes, from a random, just G, think of it as completely random graph.
Uniform?
Uniform, yes. So at this point we kind of forgot about all our, in some sense, we forgot about how we came up with this pseudo-distribution and all that, and now we're just basically saying, we want to say that with high probability when G is drawn uniformly, if we define this matrix, which is, some explicit matrix well-defined as above, then it's going to and it's going to satisfy this need. So it seems like a very, so these dependencies can be very bad. And the main thing that we use to try to still handle this is this notion of symmetry. So M has this property that you know, if you permute the graph, right, if you permute the graph, then it induces a permutation on the entries of M. Right, if you permute the vertices of the graph, it induces a permutation on the entries of M, because right, M kind of depends in the entry in symmetric ways, right? So kind of a crucial property that we are going to use is symmetry. That for every pi permutation of n, m basically m of pi I pi j pi g. So how does it work? I'm always confused. I think g equals m. This is the right thing, or there are remaining spy inverse. is the right thing? Yeah, I can't think maybe. I think this is the right thing, basically. But basically, I think you understand what I'm saying is that, you know, if you kind of say switch vertex 3 with vertex 17. In the graph, then the matrix is basically obtained by taking every set where vertex 3 appears and switching it with vertex 17, and vice versa, right? So this symmetry is actually extremely useful for us. So in particular, what it means is that if we think, so now let's speak of M as a polynomial, right? So let's speak of particular, right? So if we think of M as a polynomial, right, so m at the point I and j, it's some polynomial, right? It's some coefficients. Actually, we wrote exactly these coefficients, but at the point, at the moment, we don't care exactly what it's called. So what we know is, in some sense, if we look at t is kind of a subset of edges, right? So we can think of t as a subset of for example, let's just suppose that I is 1, 2 and j is 3, 4. So let's just try this 1, 2, 3, 4, and suppose that for example t is something like this. This is 7, right? So by the symmetry, we kind of see that the coefficient of this t would be the same as the coefficient of this when instead of 7 we put here 32. Like by symmetry, this needs to be the same coefficient. So the coefficient really doesn't depend on the, you know, the exact, the coefficient for t doesn't really depend on the exact edges that appear there, but rather on the shape of these edges. So this is the crucial thing, is to basically say a shape is basically, you take a graph, with at most, say, tau edges, or some size at most tau, where it has some labeled parts which we think of as the left part and the right part, and some edges between them. And basically, So let's call this shape sigma is a labeled graph, and basically M sigma is this matrix where M sigma, maybe I should call it like M sigma at the point ij, is the sum over all t that has this shape sigma, where the left is equal to I and the right part is equal to j of chi t. Okay, so this is the basic kind of, this is basically M sigma is the basic symmetric somosymmetric matrix valued polynomial that corresponds to the shape sigma. And basically now we know, well, now we can see that now we can say that we know that our M, because it is symmetric, it's the sum over all sigma, it's the sum over all sigma that are of size at most tau. Where it's a real shame that my sigma and tau look so similar. I'll try to make them a little bit different. Of some alpha, some coefficient depending on sigma, M sigma. Right? Just because it's symmetric. Just because it's symmetric, it means that it, and because all the monomials are small, it automatically means that you can expand it as a sum of these basic symmetric functions, right? So now, if you think about it, we have done here a pretty important thing. Because, M is like this n to the d, by n to the d by n to the d matrix, etc. And now this crazy random variable, we have deduced it to a constant size, right? It's just a constant number of parameters. You basically have, right, so you have alpha, alpha corresponding to maybe this guy, with this guy, alpha corresponding to, this guy, with this guy, this guy. So, it's not a small number, but it's a finite number of parameters, and that completely characterizes M. So this is, here is another open problem. Maybe it's actually even easy to show in principle, but I don't know. Is say show a finite computation just show, that given given alpha given some alpha sigma for all sigma of size at most tau. Determines if sum alpha sigma m sigma g is PSD with high or maybe with high probability or something like that, or maybe determines the expectation of the lambda mean, this is in some sense what we really want to know. Or show some simple sufficient condition on these alpha sigmas that implies this. Or more generally, maybe show some way to compute the spectrum of some alpha sigma and sigma given this image. Now, in our case, basically, these alpha sigmas are not that hard to compute. So this is actually like an exercise, basically. Where is this coefficient? Uh,
So basically, so in our case, it's basically alpha sigma is going to be basically omega over n to the number of vertices in C. So that kind of comes out of this thing. It's actually pretty straightforward, right? For every sigma, you're basically going to look at the number of in some sense, for every sigma, this is going to correspond to the shape is going to come from S U N T. The shape would be some graph from S U N T, and where S is the part that's labeled. So this is an exercise. But the point here is, I mean, especially this time, it's not exactly to. So I want to give you some intuition of how we go from here. Okay, so now what we want to prove is that this thing is PSD. And now, unfortunately, it's not super easy. It's actually like still quite complicated, but let's start to getting some intuition, as much intuition I can give you in like these 10 minutes. So one case is like very simple case. So suppose that sigma is this thing. Just a single edge, this is left, this is right. So what is M sigma of G? Right, so M sigma of G is basically at the point ij, right, you just put, it's just basically chi the edge ij. Right, because at the point ij, you basically put this graph. So it's just, so just chi ij. So it's basically the, let's call it, so basically, this matrix is simply going to be minus one if there is an edge and plus one if there isn't an edge. So let's call it the plus minus one adjacency matrix, let's just call it G hat. And if you look at M, you know, if you look at M corresponding to, say, two edges, then it's going to be G hat tensor G hat. And then basically one thing that you should notice about this G hat is that these matrices are always going to be, these M sigmas are always going to have like plus minus one entries. So if they're random, the spectral norm is going to be square root the dimension. And these matrices are going to be like this matrix and this matrix both have this property that the spectral norm is square root of the dimension. And then there is this lemma, which is somehow crucial, and the following thing is, it says that suppose that sigma, you know, is this thing, it has left and right. Let me not worry about these things where left and right intersect right now. And suppose that this sigma and both of these are of size t. So suppose that sigma has t vertex disjoint paths. From L to R, then the M sigma is less than O tilde square root of the dimension of M sigma. The dimension, this is a matrix of N to the T by N to the T, so this O tilde of N to the T over 2. Okay, so this is in some sense the first result that one needs to prove
on these things. How do you prove it? It's not that hard. It's it's like a page or something in the you can find it in the paper, maybe half a page. Basically, what you do is you compute the expectation of the trace of m sigma transpose all that raised to some power L. And this trace always gives you some kind of an upper bound on a certain norm. If you take L big enough, it's a decent upper bound. And basically what it says is that this thing behaves like in some sense, you know, if sigma, one way to prove it is basically to say that if you add edges to sigma, it somehow only reduces the spectral norm. That's something that one needs to prove. And it cannot increase it by more than some kind of low order terms. And when say sigma is exactly like basically just a bunch of vertex joint paths, it basically behaves as if it was like a matching. And when it is a matching, then we kind of know exactly what it's going to be. So this is one thing we know, and in some sense, if all the sigmas we had to worry about were like this, then we would be in very good shape. The reason is, in some sense, if all the sigmas we had to worry about were like this, then in some sense the off-diagonal part would have a spectral norm like a random graph, and then we would have no issues at all, because basically in our, roughly speaking, in our moment matrix, it looks something like that. It's like n to the d over 2 by n to the d over 2. And these guys are like omega n to the d over 2. And these kind of off-diagonal guys can be like omega over n to the d, but there are many of them. They are like n to the... And there are n to the d of them. So if this off-diagonal part behaved like if this off-diagonal part behaved something like a random matrix, then we would kind of say that this is basically like omega over n to the d over 2 plus some matrix plus, you know, omega over n to the d over 2 plus some matrix R such that the spectral norm of R is at most n to the d over 4. And then, if you do the calculations, then this is fine. This will be positive, but this will be like n to the d over 2 I plus this thing, and then, you know, this will be PSD as long as omega is much smaller than square root n. So if everything was random, then we would be completely fine. But and everything was random would kind of correspond to the case that, say, the only shapes that get non-zero coefficients are shapes that have these disjoint paths between them. But this is not the case. All shapes get non-zero coefficients. And then what we want to do is we basically want to say the following thing, and this is where things become more messy. Let me maybe write it here and just. So basically, we have some shape where there is no vertex disjoint path, and by kind of Menger's theorem, what it means is that there is a vertex separator. So we basically have, like, say, T on this left. At some point, we have to worry about intersection, but let's not worry about it right now. T on this left, T on this right, but there is a vertex separator. There is some vertex separator, there is some part in the middle where somehow of size T prime. And where everything has to go through this obstacle. And then we're kind of going to go the leftmost obstacle, the rightmost obstacle, so we're going to separate things into left, right, and middle. And we're basically going to say this graph is actually a union of three graphs. The left part, the middle part, and the right part. And the nice thing is that if it's a union of three graphs that are edges joined, then, you know, chi corresponding to this T will be basically chi left, chi middle, chi right. And the middle part is basically the kind of the part that we have basically already know how to handle. And this left and right part, basically what we are going to do is kind of sum over all over them and kind of treat them as a way to somehow factorize our matrix. So this may be a little bit vague, but I hope it at least gives you some clue. If you now go and read the paper, maybe it will make more sense than it would have otherwise. Okay? So that's it.